Surround us with a circle of love. Let our hearts keep singing and the song keep ringing through our lives as we leave this place, my friend. And may the music never end. May the music never end. Surround us with a circle of love. Let our hearts keep singing and the song keep ringing through our lives as we leave this place, my friend. And may the music never end.
I want to thank our beautiful singers, Mountain View High School Madrigals, under the direction of Jill Denny. Aren't they gorgeous? They will be singing throughout the program today. I'd like to ask you to stand for the playing of the bagpipes, the parade of the honor guards, the national anthem, and the placement of the flags.
Oh, beautiful. For spacious skies, for amber waves of rain, for purple mountain majesties upon the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with fatherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful, for heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness and every gain divine. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free, of the free, and the home of the brave, home of the
Please be seated. I'd like to ask Navy Chaplain Diana Brady to come forth and do the invocation.
Let us be together in the spirit of prayer. O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast, and our eternal home. You are our creator and sustainer, our light in the darkness, and our fortress in the midst of every well-fought fight and time of trouble. You moved upon men and women to establish this great nation. You stirred them to hope and to dream for a land of freedom. We praise you for this great nation, which even today offers that same promise and that same hope and still shines as a light to the nations of the world. You have inspired many of our best and brightest to volunteer to proudly stand and defend our beloved country. You have given us brave and loyal men and women who have steadfastly served in their chosen branch of our military and in our communities as courageous first responders, prepared to save, ready to serve, willing to protect, even if it means giving their very lives. We gather with grateful hearts and minds to honor, acknowledge, and remember them, all who willingly enter into danger when others flee in the midst of chaos. We acknowledge that their service and their sacrifice enables us to walk, to work, and to live as free and protected people in this great land and in our community, affirming and embracing the precious freedom to live, to worship, to speak, and to dream as our hearts and conscience dictates. Knowing, loving God, that in our time together with loved ones is our most precious resource, especially with loved ones you've gifted with a special heart to serve, where time together is sacrificed for the greater good. For those families who have lost loved ones through sacrificial service, may they receive the blessing of cherished memories that never will forget the one they love, and healing comfort for aching hearts. For it is honest to ask, can it be in a world this full and busy that the loss of one creature creates a void in any heart so wide and so deep that nothing but the vast width and depth of eternity can fill it. Be thou their refuge and their strength. We also humbly ask your blessing upon this gathered community today as we remember, honor, and bear witness to devotion to duty, which continues to serve as a shining beacon of love made manifest in noble service, that the longed-for, promised day of peace, where there will be no more mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, will at last come upon the earth. Amen.
Welcome to our 12th year of our Veterans Day ceremony. Can you hear me? Okay. As I introduce people today, I will acknowledge some of the people that started this and that are still with us also. But this is really about Veterans Day, except when Donna Axelson and I decided to build this memorial, we decided it should not only be for veterans, but it should also be for our active duty military and our first responders. So we always acknowledge our veterans for sure, but also those in active duty and our first responders who are amongst us and with us every day. So let's start out by acknowledging the veterans that are here today. And we have a number of World War II veterans with us here today, and they will have a part in our ceremony also. But I have two of my World War II veteran guests sitting right up here with me that I'd like to introduce to you. Ralph Robinson, who was a World War II Army Air Corps. Ralph, welcome very much. And I can't believe he still can get in his uniform. And Pauline Bessler, who is also a World War II, one of our original waves, who's still here. Both of them live in Cupertino. Both of them will have a part further down in the ceremony, but I wanted them to be my guests up here at the podium with us. It's just so special to have them with us. And there are other World War II vets here also. Let's give a big round of hands for all of our World War II veterans. And while we're at it, if you are a veteran, will you please stand? Or if you're standing, would you raise your hand so we can say thank you to all of you? For all that you do, for all that you have done, for all that you continue to do, because as the military community has embraced me, as I've become involved in our memorial here and in various activities, it's very clear to me that once most of our veterans are out of office, they stay very active in their local communities, many of them doing things for other veterans or active duty military or just in their own community for those in special need or help or support. And so I know that they continue to be an integral part of our lives, an important part of our lives. And the reason we can all be here on this absolutely gorgeous sunny day, I don't want to say this out loud, but this is our 12th year and we have not been rained out yet. So it's, I shouldn't say that. I should not say that. I know I shouldn't have said that. Okay. a few sprinkles before, and the day that we dedicated this in 2007, it poured all night long until 6 o'clock in the morning. But God has been good to us, as Donna tells us, and has always been here to shine on our memorial so that we can all be here to say thank you to those that we need to say thank you to. And by the way, there's a group this year that we included when we did this memorial, and it's a memorial wall right there that some of you are sitting on, and that's okay to sit on it, that's dedicated to our first responder. And has this been a year when our first responders have been busy, even busier than normal? And let's give them a big thank you. They come every year. They've come every year since the first one. All I have to do is one email to the fire chief and the sheriff, and they're here. They come with smiles on their face. They bring their beautiful ladder trucks and fly our flag that we're also attached to, an integral part of our community, important part of our community. And by the way, our city employees are also part of our first responders. So having said that, let me introduce to you our city council, starting with our mayor, Savita Vatnyatin, our Vice Mayor Darcy Paul, Councilman Barry Chang, Councilman Rod Sinks, and Councilman Stephen Scharf. I don't see our city manager, but maybe he's here somewhere, David Brandt. But our former city manager and a veteran, Dave Knapp, who was an integral part of getting this done, is here. Dave, stand up and say hi. I also know that there are representatives from Assemblyman Evan Lowe's office and from our Congressman Ro Khanna's office here to show their respect, and I thank you for coming. And we do have a former Congresswoman here. Mary Bono's here, our former Congresswoman. So say hello to Mary Bono, too. Having said that, I'd like to invite our mayor to come forward and say a few words, as is traditional each year for us. Savita.
Thank you so much, Sandy. Hello, everyone. Welcome to this wonderful day. It's such a wonderful day for this celebration. I am so happy to see you all here and those standing behind. I'm sorry, I can't turn around and see everybody. Thank you all for being here. I feel blessed, like the chaplain said, to be standing up here and having this privilege to honor our veterans on this day. I want to thank each and every veteran across the United States for their bravery and sacrifice to our country. To all the veterans here in attendance today and our first responders and those in active duty, I cannot express how much I am in awe of all that you've done, the courage that you've shown, and just for the love of your country, our country. Thank you for what you've done. Everyone says thank you for your service. It gives me goosebumps every time I say that. Because of you, someone like me is able to stand here and actually give this address. If it wasn't for you fighting on those front lines and your families that supported you, we wouldn't have this wonderful community that we have in Cupertino and the great country that we have in America. America is definitely a better place, and I again thank you for your service. On my way here, every time this happens to me, I look at the flag in my front yard. I look at it and I say, I am able to fly this flag. I came in here as an immigrant, but you gave me this opportunity to fly that flag in my front yard, saluted, and be so proud of it, that I can wear the stars and stripes, I can salute it, and you allow me to do that. So thank you, thank you, thank you. If you look around you, you'll see people of different ethnicities, different ages. They look different. They look different from you, but we all bleed the same. We all want the same for this wonderful country. We all want the same for our children to live and prosper in this great community of Cupertino. And I've been here for more than 20 years. Growing up in India, I've never been in a city for more than 2 years. So for me, when I think home, this is home. I'll do anything and everything for my home. And I thank you for allowing me to call this place my home. We recently heard some Monte Vista students talk about their experiences talking to other veterans. I want to encourage the Madrigals, the Mountain View High School, please meet our veterans, talk to them, hear their stories. They started out as ordinary people, but then they went on to accomplish extraordinary feat that made them heroes, our heroes. Not the ones in the comic books, real life heroes. And please stop and talk to them. Pause and hear their stories. Learn from them and take that in your heart with you. Maybe later on in the day you'll have family events, you'll have a barbecue. You may celebrate in different ways, but keep in mind the veterans who allow you to celebrate in any fashion you want in the country that you love, the country and the community you call home. Every time I come here, I think, if I had a son, what would have happened? I don't have a son, but there is a child here who is a son of immigrants who chose to be in active duty. So I'm giving some of my time to him. I want him to say a few things to encourage our young students here to follow a path that you laid out for us. And you showed us that this is the way to show your love for the country. Over to Lieutenant J.G. Vikram Kant. Thank you all for having me here today. Thank you. Welcome. Might need to raise this a little bit.
Maybe just a little bit. I think this will work. Sivieta, thank you for the wonderful introduction. I'm truly humbled today to be in the presence of real heroes. To be 100% honest, nothing can thank you for the sacrifices you have made for this country to provide me the opportunity to wear this uniform and represent this nation. I'm personally very grateful for that. The military, because of your leadership, mentorship, and guidance, is a better organization than when you first entered. And that's the goal for us all, is that when we join an organization, we make it better than when it was started. You guys have all done that, and by doing so, you have paved the way for people like me to join the military and make our own imprints. In the Navy, we say, when people retire, we say, you've been relieved, we have the watch. And because of your effort, we have the watch. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I hope he serves as a good role model for our young students present everywhere. Thank you again. Enjoy your Veterans Day. Happy Veterans Day.
And we put it back down to my size, huh? Our first speaker today is Major General James M. Myatt. General Myatt was commissioned a Marine Corps second lieutenant after graduating with a Bachelor of Science degree in physics from Sam Houston State University in Huntsville, Texas. He holds a master's degree in engineering electronics from a naval postgraduate school. General Myatt served two combat tours in the Republic of Vietnam. His first tour was as a platoon and company commander with the 1st Battalion, 4th Marines. And he was awarded the Silver Star, the nation's third largest award for valor. During his second tour, he was assigned as infantry battalion advisor to the 5th Battalion, Vietnamese Marine Corps. He commanded the 1st Marine Division during Operation Desert Shield and Desert Storm in 1990 and 91. His division defeated 7 Iraqi Army divisions in zone, seized Kuwait International Airport, and liberated Kuwait City. General Myatt retired from the United States Marine Corps in 1995 to work for Bechtel Corporation. While working for Bechtel, he managed the $22 billion construction project to build the Korean high-speed rail from Seoul to Busan. In September 2001, General Myatt was selected to be president and CEO of the Marines Memorial Association, and he served with great distinction in that position until his retirement just last week. He is a very active supporter of the VA and the Gold Star Mothers, and has created a memorial at MMA to all of the fallen soldiers, sailor, and airmen since 9/11. Matt Axelson's picture and biography are also on the wall of Marine Memorial in view of Matt's sacrifice and highest award for valor. Please join me in welcoming Major General Myatt and his wife, Wendy Lee Myatt.
Thank you for that kind introduction. I'll crank it up a little bit. Madam Mayor, Admiral Andrews, Don and Corky Axelson, and members of the Cupertino community, I am truly honored to be here. Thank you for inviting me and my wife, Wendy Lee, to be here with you for this. This thing is amazing. I've seen a lot of memorials in my time, but this is one of the finest I've seen. And then with these pavers, that you could make you go to school just by spending a day learning about the people and the tributes that are on these pavers. I think that's wonderful. So I'm really, really glad to be here. And I also thank you, Senator, for recognizing the first responders. In our recent wildfires, in the Bear Fire on the road to Santa Cruz, and in the wine country, where Wendy and I have a home in Sonoma, and we are so, so dedicated and grateful to the first responders here today. I thank you all very much. As mentioned, I just retired after 16 years at the president of the Marines Memorial Association. I woke up on 1 November 2017 with nothing that I had to do. It was the first time in my professional life. At the Marines Memorial Association, we run the Marines Memorial Club, which is a living memorial to honor the legacy of military service. And all members of all veterans of all the services can join. Soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and Coasties. On the fourth floor, we do have a picture of Lieutenant Mike Murphy, who received the Medal of Honor for Operation Red Wings. And on floor seven, we honor all the Navy Cross recipients, including photographs of Danny Dietz and Marcus Luttrell, and yes, Cupertino's own Matt Axelson, an American warrior. The names of Axelson and Dietz and Murphy are repeated in small plaques on our memorial wall on floor 10M. It's a tribute to all service members we've lost since 9/11. I invite you to come to San Francisco, tour the living memorial, rejoice in our history, have a meal on the 12th floor overlooking the city of San Francisco, and take a moment to ponder the service of our gallant service members as we do here today. Veterans Day, originally called Armistice Day, is celebrated to mark the end of World War I, the war to end all wars. The war to end all wars. I was curious where that came from, so I looked it up. H.G. Wells wrote a series of essays during World War I. And he published a book in the last year of the war, 1918, because he believed that defeating Germany, we would end all wars. And in a book titled, The War That Will End All War, it became the most common catchphrase of World War I. If only it had been true. If only it had been true. The guns went silent on the 11th hour of 11th day of the 11th month in 1918. Next year, we're going to be celebrating that and the battles that the Americans fought in World War I and commemorated. Operation Red Wings is the most devastating loss of Navy SEALs and Army Special Operations personnel in Afghanistan. And we hope it's never repeated. Matt Axelson on the impressive bronze and the SEAL buddy James Suh are two heroes who speak for the larger group who were lost that day. As Matt was a true son of Cupertino and all the others gave their lives that day, as well as Marcus Luttrell, the lone survivor. The papers here from the community, and I'm told from every school, speak volumes about the community sense of responsibility and honoring its service members. Indeed, this memorial commemorates 42 sons of Cupertino who lost their lives in the country World War II, Vietnam, Iraq, and Afghanistan. You know, a leader has to, you lose a lot of yourself when one of your men die or women die carrying out your orders. I remember the very first Marine that was killed carrying out my orders. I was a young lieutenant in Vietnam. On my first tour, my platoon sergeant, Staff Sergeant Virgolito, was trying to help me get my platoon out of the way of a killing zone of North Vietnamese machine guns. When he jumped up to move to a squad to be able to be more effective fire, and he was cut down, I felt like I'd lost my brother. I was shocked. And he was the first Marine to die carrying out my orders. Over the next 32 years, there were many, many more. And I can't remember all their names. I have to have a diary. I'm ashamed. A little bit of me died when he died, and all the Marines that died under my command, a whole lot of me died. In watching Lone Survivor, I was struck by the courage and ferocity of our warriors, including James and Matt. But I was struck by the unusual approach of the filmmakers by involving the families who were lost that day. We, in our own way at the Marines Memorial, try to provide a similar experience with the Gold Star parents, an annual meeting of the families, so that they may learn to grieve together. Because, in World War II, we had enough casualties in some San Francisco that one Catholic church had its own Gold Star Mothers chapter. Today, you can be the only person in your congregation that even has anybody serving in the military. And we brought those people together so they could grieve together and learn and network. So our club honors the courage and bravery of thousands. The movie honors those who participated in Operation Red Wings, to include Cindy Eccleston and Donna and Corky and others who work with the film company to honor their loved ones. The Cupertino Veterans Memorial is the nation's first memorial to Afghanistan, as I know, the only one. It was built by a community of Cupertino, including all of its citizens, its first responders, its teachers, its students. It's a splendid tribute to our warriors and to their devotion, to their sacrifice. It is fitting that we celebrate today and commemorate on this Veterans Day 2017, think about all those who have gone before us. So I congratulate you, and we thank you for concluding Wendy and me in this service today. Thank you.
Okay, so I was going to save this for the last, but it seems real appropriate for me to share it with you now. Donna and I like to talk about those little God things that happen during the time we built this memorial and as it's grown over the years. Just the wonderful stories people have shared with us and the experiences we've had. And it reminds me, as General Myatt was speaking, that some of you may not know what a Gold Star family is. And a Gold Star family is a family who has lost a member in active duty military experience. And we do have Gold Star families with us today. So I think it's appropriate that we ask them to stand so we can say, we're here for you. We admire you. Thank you for your sacrifice. And the Suff family, the Axelson family, I think there are others. Please stand. I will tell you that one of the organizations that our little nonprofit does contribute to is the Navy SEAL Foundation. And Donna and I and our partners were at their annual event recently, and seated at our table was a young Navy SEAL who had just come back from his second deployment to Mosul. He was there with his wife, and we hope he's going to speak next year when we dedicate the Iraq-Afghanistan Memorial Stone. He said he would if he's not deployed. He sent a wonderful email to us, and I was going to share part of it with you, and I think this is a really good time to do that. As General Myatt mentioned, the Gold Star families. So here is part of his email to me, and I quote, "I realize now that being a SEAL is child's play compared to the strength of mind it takes to be a family member of a warrior. The sacrifices made by my personal heroes who have gone before me are shouldered by the parents, wives, children, and siblings they leave behind. It was one of the highest honors of my life so far to get to spend the weekend getting to know these people. One of those people is Donna Axelson, my partner in building this memorial, and she's going to come now and introduce our next speaker, Donna.
That's no fair to do something emotional like that and then ask me to speak. I look forward to this day every year to come and remember our veterans. And I see so many faces I recognize. I don't remember all your names, but I recognize your faces. And I thank you for joining us each year to remember our veterans. Before I introduce our next speaker, I want to tell a little story about him. So our military tend to be very humble and don't broadcast what they've done. So the first time I met Steve, we were at a Navy SEAL Foundation dinner event. Steve's brother, Pete, was a Navy SEAL who was killed while he was in the teams. And as we went around the table and introduced ourselves, Steve stood up and he said, my name is Steve Oswald. I'm a retired naval aviator. And as we went around the table and other people were introduced, a former SEAL that was sitting next to me stood up to introduce himself, and he looked at Steve and he said, Admiral, it's so nice to have you here this evening. And I thought, retired naval aviator, Admiral, of course, because they are so humble. So let me tell you a little bit about my friend Steve. He's a 1973 graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy, and he graduated as an aerospace engineer. In 1978, he graduated from the U.S. Naval Test Pilot School. He spent more than 30 years in the Navy and working for NASA. So besides being a naval aviator and a test pilot, he was also a space shuttle astronaut. And he was involved in three different space shuttle missions, piloting two missions aboard Discovery in 1992 and 1993. So it's my great pleasure and honor to introduce my friend and retired naval aviator, Steve Oswald.
So it's great to be here with you. You guys are short. Actually, being tall wasn't an advantage flying some of those airplanes. Fortunately, the space shuttle is really a pretty big flying machine, and it was, especially when you got to zero G, there was all kinds of room. So it was wonderful. But it's great to be here with you. You know, Donna and Sandy wanted us to come in uniform, I think, including General Myatt. My wife Mary and I had recently moved, and I have no idea where the uniforms are. And I didn't want to know whether or not they still fit. I probably weigh about the same amount, but I think it's redistributed a little differently than it was once upon a time. So General Myers and I decided to wear the Navy Marine Corps, actually, across all services, the alternate uniform is blue jacket and either khaki slacks or gray slacks. So I did khaki and the general did gray, and you have alternate civilian dress uniform, junior officer, right? Right, General? Yeah. You only had one jacket, and it was blue, right? And it was in with the rest of the stuff. So they say it's good to start out with something that's a little funny. I think this is funny. There are some folks out there that look like you're of the Air Force persuasion. I hope you think it's funny, too. My Air Force buddies think it is. But there was a survey that was done, informal survey, and there were four members, one from each service, that were there, and the interviewer said, what would you do if you found a scorpion in your tent? And the Army guy says, I'd stomp on it. Navy guy, being a little bit more innovative, said I'd take my boot off and I'd whack it with the heel of my boot. The Marine said I would rip its head off and eat it. And the Air Force guy said I'd call room service and ask him what the heck a tent was doing in my room. So to try to dig myself out of that hole, I thought I'd tell a little story about the Marine Corps and the Navy and the Army Air Corps and the Army. It's not a recent story. It's the Guadalcanal campaign, and you could talk for a long time up here about this. I'm going to try to squish this down because I want to talk about two nights. In November of 1942, which was several months after the Marines had landed on Guadalcanal on the 7th of August, 1942, pretty much unopposed relative to what they went through on a lot of other islands that the Marines landed on in World War II. And their objective was to take an airfield that the Japanese had started to build. They renamed it Henderson Field. The island of Guadalcanal, the code name within the Allies, was Cactus. So when they flew just a few days later after the Marines had landed, the Navy and the Marine Corps and the Army Air Corps flew airplanes in there and established the Cactus Air Force. That was a big deal in the Guadalcanal campaign because the Japanese had some carriers in the area, but they tended to stay away. It was a long way to Rabaul, about 800 miles, so flying down from Rabaul was a tactical disadvantage for them. So it evolved into a situation where the Japanese owned the nighttime, but we owned air superiority during the daytime, and so the Japanese generally didn't operate down there during the daytime. So the Marines were more than maybe just a little bit aggravated with the Navy after the landing because for a number of reasons, the Navy was kind of absent for weeks, maybe even a couple of months, and so the Marines were undersupplied. And I think that they had a legitimate gripe about the Navy's support. But then Admiral Halsey took over as the three-star commander of that whole operation. And it turned out they got intelligence that there were Japanese battleships coming down the slot between Guadalcanal and Savo Island, and their intent was to shell the airplanes and the personnel on Henderson Field. On the night of Friday the 13th of November 1942. So Halsey ordered Task Force 67, the flagship of which was the USS San Francisco. So I think it's appropriate to tell the story here in the Bay Area. of a ship that bears the city's name. But when the captain of San Francisco heard about the mission from the flag officer assigned to his ship, he said, this is a suicide mission. And Admiral Callahan said, yes, but we've got to do it. And so they sailed north into the slot as the Japanese sailed south. And over 2 hours, they slugged it out in what was called a bar fight after the lights had been shot out. And the American force was pretty well decimated. They lost four cruisers, two cruisers of four. The other two were heavily damaged. They had four destroyers sunk. Most of the remaining four destroyers were badly damaged. They lost 1,439 people, including the captain of the San Francisco and the embarked flag officer. But they sunk two Japanese destroyers and damaged one of the two battleships to the point where it couldn't get back out of harm's way before the sun came up, and it was sunk later that day by the Cactus Air Force and planes from the USS Enterprise. So I'll get back to the San Francisco in just a minute, but the Navy learned a few things from that, one of which was if you have a new gadget that the other guys don't have, you might want to use it. So the very next night, two battleships, one equipped with radar, the USS Washington, went out and met another two Japanese battleships, four cruisers, eight destroyers, sank a battleship, badly damaged a couple of cruisers, and that was the last night that the Japanese came down the slot to try to shell Henderson Field. That was in November. By the end of December, the Japanese had made the decision not to continue to occupy Guadalcanal. They evacuated Guadalcanal by January, and on the 9th of February, we declared victory in the Guadalcanal campaign, which was the beginning of the end for the Japanese in the Pacific in World War II, and the end of the beginning of the U.S. and Allied forces' island-hopping strategy to eventually defeat the Japanese in the Pacific in August of 1945. So, back to San Francisco. That one night, over the course of the campaign, there were 16 Medals of Honor given out to folks from various services, seven to the Marine Corps, five to the Navy, three to the Army, and one to the Coast Guard, the only Coast Guard recipient of the Medal of Honor in our nation's history. But three of the five Navy Medals of Honor were given out to crewmen of the USS San Francisco. San Francisco was, the crew, was also awarded 22 Navy crosses and a dozen Silver Stars. One of the things that they learned in that campaign is that it's a bad idea to put family members on the same ship. One of the cruisers was the USS Juno. The Sutherland brothers, five of them, were stationed aboard Juno, and all of them were lost. In succeeding years, there were 28 Navy warships named for various heroes of the Battle of Friday the 13th. One of those was the Sutherlands, and another was the USS Harmon, named for the first African-American warship, or warship that was named for an African-American hero, Leonard Harmon, who was a mess specialist aboard USS San Francisco. So, the Navy is an organization that has 200 years of tradition, almost unimpeded by progress, right? But we learn slowly. And, you know, when I went to the Naval Academy, Leonard Harmon was a mess specialist because at the time, that was about all you could be if you were a black guy in the Navy. You were going to be a mess specialist. And when I went to the Naval Academy in 1969, and the whole time that I was there through 1973, all of the stewards, we called them, were either black or Filipino. If you go there now, the population of the mess specialists that work in the galley and in the dining hall look like us. They're representative of the way that America is put together in terms of ethnicities and genders. And we're much better for that. I got my wings in 1974, which was the year after the first female naval aviators earned their wings in the Navy. And it was a long haul, and there was a lot of resistance to putting women in Navy squadrons, putting women in Navy ships. But we're better for having done that. And we are pretty much through the transition of that, although we can do better. We like to say it's a work in progress, but at least one of those words is progress, right? So Donna said I had to talk about space flying. I won't do that, but I will talk about how it turns out that Dwight Eisenhower made a decision, certainly not his most important decision, but one of them that he made was that our astronauts are going to be selected from the Corps of Military Trained Test Pilots, which cuts down on the selection stuff, right? And because it was working okay for Mercury and Gemini and Apollo, they were still doing that when shuttle came around. So all the pilot astronauts had to be military trained test pilots. So if you're a mission specialist, PhD or an MD or whatever, you're competing against 10,000 people. Pilots only compete against 200. The odds are much better, right? So because of stumbling into the United States Navy at the right time and being privileged to be able to go test fly some airplanes, which was an awful lot of fun, I got to go see our world from a vantage point that most people don't get to see it. And it's something pretty special about being able to do one lap around the world every 90 minutes, 16 sunrises and 16 sunsets every day. It's pretty cool. But, you know, I want to thank you for allowing me to do that, because your taxpayer dollars paid for all of that, right? But I also wanted to thank... we come out here every year, a couple times a year actually, maybe even several times a year, and we get to go stay over at Half Moon Bay because a guy that I met on the telephone, it's a long story, but Mark Kendall is here. He is one of several people with a Navy SEAL Foundation shirt on. There's another one. And we participate in a couple of golf events that benefit the Navy SEAL Foundation, which is a foundation that helps active duty special operators, and it also helps the families of fallen Navy SEALs in trying to manage, you know, what's left after the fact. And it's a tremendous bonding event. And every year, unfortunately, you welcome another Gold Star spouse or parent to the group. But it's dangerous business, and it's a long war. And these guys are going to be doing this for a long, long time. So it's important that we support them. But you know, one of the things that's different about the military of today versus the military of Vietnam or World War II or World War I, Korea, all the way back to the Spanish-American War, there was this thing they called the draft. And folks still have to register for the draft, just in case we ever need them. But we don't draft people. Everybody that's in the military today is there because they want to be. And they are so much better across the board, across all the services, than they've ever been. And they are the most lethal fighting force that we have ever had. And we should be very proud, I am, that they're out there protecting us day in and day out. So, back to my World War II story. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for your service. My dad was, Mark's dad was a Marine. My wife Mary's dad was a 18-year-old drafty B-17 waist gunner, 23 missions over Western Europe. My dad joined the Navy to beat the draft and flew in the Pacific. And he liked it so much. He liked the guys. He loved the flying that he hung around for 22 years. And that's the thing that I think the warriors of today have in common with the warriors of bygone eras is the mission and the camaraderie are the constants. And whether it's your shipmate or your squadron mate or your bunker buddy or whatever it is, they become your family where you are, and they're the reason why you stick around to do it again. So, thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for your service. Thank all of the veterans in the audience for your service. I always feel good when people thank me for my service, but I always feel bad because I want to tell them that I would have paid them to let me do what I was allowed to do, and yet they paid me. So thank you very much, all of you, for allowing me and my family to be a part of this. And for 34 good years of playing with some really neat toys. Thank you very much.
Rear Admiral Oswald has made me a hero in my family because my 3.5-year-old grandson is enamored of astronauts. We have no idea where that came from. We have absolutely no idea where he first saw anything about astronauts, but he wears his little astronaut suit everywhere. So I want an autographed photograph of you in your astronaut outfit that I can take home to my grandson. And thank you for coming. Now we get to a more emotional part of our program that everybody tells me every year they love. Don't change it. Don't change anything about it. We want you to do it the same all the time. Well, we change a little bit. But this is the part where we have flowers placed at the sculpture and a wreath that is placed at the Wall of Honor. The Wall of Honor behind us has the names of those that died in active duty from the area. You do not need to be from Cupertino. This is an expanded memorial. Likewise, the pavers that everyone keeps referring to, please do read them. They're amazing. We just installed 7 more, I think, last week. It's a wonderful way to memorialize someone in your family or just people in general. The children have wonderful messages on the ones that they have too. This is our way to make it very personal. So right now we are going to have our 2 of our Gold Star families, the Suff family and the Axelson family, take flowers to the sculpture. And this year, the 3rd person will be Pauline Bessler, our World War II vet, who will be here representing our World War II veterans, and she will also carry a bouquet. So we will start with the Suff family, and if we could have the music, please.
When I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky, the first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane. Or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. And I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. I'm gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. And I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain and so much darkness in this world we stumble through. All these questions I can't answer, so much work to do. I get where I'm going, and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Yeah, when I get where I'm going,
I could ask the honor guard to come get the wreath and prepare it. And then after they have that set up, I'm going to ask all our World War II veterans to come forward behind them, and they will need some help. So probably some of our honor guards or our first responders, our family members can help them. Can you move forward a little bit so they can get behind you? So if our World War II veterans can come behind them, okay, and then the choir will sing, and we will walk to the Wall of Honor to place the wreath. So please come forward, and if Ralph and Pauline can get us started. Veteran, you need help, just raise your hand. We'll get someone to help you.
If you do,
Walk,
walk,
walk a mile,
walk a mile,
walk, walk a mile in your neighbor's shoes.
Walk,
walk a mile,
walk a mile,
walk, walk a mile in your neighbor's shoes.
Walk,
walk a mile,
walk a mile,
walk, walk a mile in your neighbor's shoes. You'll understand them better if you do.
Walk a mile,
walk a mile and see.
See the world,
the world.
See
you will
the
see.
World.
See the world,
see the world.
Your neighbor's eyes.
See
you the
see
world.
The world.
You will see
the world.
See the world through your neighbor's eyes.
See the world.
You will see
the world.
See the world through your neighbor's eyes.
There's
so many things you'll come to.
Walk a mile,
walk a mile and
live a day.
If you live a day in the neighborhood,
if you live a day,
live a day in the neighborhood,
live a day.
If you live a day in the neighborhood,
you'd
understand them better if you could. If you could, you will understand them better. Walk a mile in your neighbor's shoes, their shoes. Walk a mile.
They are wonderful, are they not? Our World War II vets. Thank you. Let's give them time to be seated.
Walk a mile in your neighbor's shoes, their shoes. Walk a mile.
Before we have our benediction, I want to share with you another story, a short one. Yesterday, when we were out here putting the flags up, Michael and John Muscovich, who's taking all the pictures, and myself, a young man came here, and he was sitting right over here on this bench, just very quietly by himself, with his head down, looking at one of the pavers, very intense. And finally, I said, are you a veteran? And he said, yes. I said, World War II? He said, yes. He said, I come here all the time. My wife and I used to come constantly. And I said, are you coming tomorrow? You know, I hope you're going to come to our ceremony. He goes, no. I it's too painful. He said, what is so painful about it? You know, we're going to be celebrating all that you've accomplished for us. And he said, my wife died on this day. This would have been yesterday, the 10th, a year ago. And we used to come here frequently. We would sit right there and visit the memorial. So he comes every day at 3 o'clock to sit here and visit with his wife. And that's not the first person that's told us stories like that about this memorial. It's just one of the touching ones that really, really makes Donna and I feel how important it is that we do this, because it really has and does continue to make a difference in people's lives. And I don't see him here today, but I wouldn't out him if I did, because he said, I don't tell people I come here every day and talk to my wife. you know. But there was another time when I came here and there was a young man when we first built this, sitting here eating with a takeout thing from Hobie's, as I recall, and he was looking at what used to be fountains here and was walking around doing some last-minute things, and he said, "Sandy," and I turned around, I said, "You don't remember me, do you?" And no, I did not. And it turns out our sons, when they were quite young, played soccer together. And I said, "Oh, you're enjoying the spring day?" And he said, "No, I'm visiting with my dad. I'm talking to my dad." And I looked around. There was no other person here. Well, when you leave, there's a memorial stone right here in this area that he had paid for to dedicate to his father. And he came over frequently, still comes over frequently. And he has dinner, and he talks to his dad. So this is truly a living memorial. It touches many, many people in many different ways. And so now I'm going to ask Diana to come back up for the benediction. The Madrigals will sing a song too, and then I'll come back up and say a few words, and then we're gonna sing God Bless America together before we retire the flag. So, Diana?
Let us pray. Lord of wind and flame, you who call us to put on the whole armor of God, that our hearts and our spirits might be strengthened, that we would find the resolve to stand firm in the face of contrary winds, that we would know the courage that does not turn back but moves forever forward, running into the smoke, into the heart of the conflict, into the heat of the conflagration, because that is where those with the greatest need lie wounded and waiting for help to come. You who call us in this world of tribulation to wait patiently for your guidance, and you who remind us on days such as this one that though the foundations of the earth do shake, we are never alone. You are always with us, and we are here, all of us as one family, to live as children of God together in this beautiful yet broken world. With grateful hearts, we seek your blessing. We ask that you would bless our veterans, bless and protect our active duty military serving around the world, and bring them safely home to our loving embrace. Today, with thankful hearts, we ask a special blessing upon our first responders, our firefighters, EMS, police officers and their families, all who sacrifice and serve to keep our communities safe. As they put on their gear, breathe upon them your spirit of peace. As they wait for instructions and directions, breathe upon them your spirit of wholeness. As they go forth into houses and highways of darkness and despair, breathe on them your spirit of hope. Burn in their hearts as love while they put out flames of destruction and disaster. Beat within their hearts with the rhythm of perseverance and determination while they resuscitate travelers on the way. At each incident and accident, may your comforting presence be felt, bringing the calm assurance of your peace. When the alarm sounds and they are called to both friend and stranger, let them faithfully serve you in their neighbor. Grant them courage in fearful situations, wisdom when they must take quick action and make life-saving decisions, strength when they are weary, and compassion in all of their work. And for all who serve, when the fight is fierce, the warfare long, steals on the ear the distant triumph song, and hearts are brave again and arms are strong, may shouts of Alleluia resound in heaven and on the earth, now and forever. Amen. So be it.
Amen.
I never cease to be proud of our young people. Aren't they wonderful? Let's give them a hand. As you already heard, all of our schools, our 24 elementary middle schools, there were 24 then, there's 25 now, and all of our five high schools have raised money to have pavers when we first built this. So they're represented, and they come every year on a day off from school to sing for us. They're a different school usually each year, and we thank you so very much for being here and for honoring our veterans and getting to know more about our military, what military life is all about, what it has to offer, and what it gives to all of us so that we can be here on this incredibly gorgeous day. I'm going to ask everybody to stand now for a singing of God Bless America on the back of your program if you don't know the words, and then Taps by our wonderful Kenneth Weir and the Retirement of the Honor Guards. Please remain standing.
Beloved American composer Irving Berlin wrote God Bless America in 1918 while serving in the Army in World War I. He revived the song during the rise of Hitler and introduced it as a peace song on Armistice Day in 1938, just before World War II. While the storm clouds gather far across the sea, let us swear allegiance to a land that's free. Let us all be grateful for a land so fair and raise our voices in a solemn prayer.
If you could please be seated, I just have a few closing comments for you. I want to thank you for all for coming again every year. Some of the same people, I know Pauline has been here for all 11 years, she told me when I visited her earlier this week. A lot of you have been here all 12 years, excuse me. We will be doing our Iraq-Afghanistan memorial boulder like the ones behind us that we've done for each war. I know we promised you we'd do it this year, but we had some problems with that. But they're guaranteed next year. We even have our speakers already. And I want to end today with telling you, after our choir sings, we'll be singing a song, actually, while we do this. There are carnations, red and white carnations up here, that are yours, to please come up and take one or two and place them wherever you would like. I know some people like to place it at the medallion for their branch of the service, or on a paver for someone they love, or at the memorial, but that's our gift to you. I want to end with another little story. As we had some more pavers being engraved this week, our engraver told us this story. And they were here one day doing some engraving, and this young couple came in, and they talked for a while, and the young man went over to the Wall of Honor, and she went over to speak to the engraver, and they started to talk, and he noticed that the young man seemed to be distressed, and he asked her, you know, if there were something he could do to help, and she said no. She said, I just picked him up from the airport from Afghanistan. He just got home, and he heard about this memorial in Afghanistan, and the first thing he wanted to do was to come here and see it. So that's how special it is. I don't think I need to say another word except thank you for coming. Thank you for all our veterans, our active duty military, our first responders, and all of you for being a part of this wonderful community. Thank you.
Broken dreams.